Morning, good morning. PTSD from that first week packet, right? Welcome to a Push Green Live. This is Period 7 Part 2 review, right? Thanks for everybody for being here. Don't forget to comment your name when you get a chance. Make sure your attendance is up to date, right? All right, let's get it started. Hopefully everybody's having a great morning already. You have T-minus 3 days till AP exam, right? This Friday at 1:30 p.m. you will log on. I know the exam's at 2, but you have to log on half an hour early, right? So I thought if you checked or you get the updates from Google Classroom, you'll see that I posted some stuff this morning, like 5 o'clock or something like that, 5:30. I don't know. I woke up at like 4 o'clock in the morning. I was like, oh, I got to do a couple things. I've been wanting to make a list for you guys, and I got up and just knocked it out. And so it's a list of things that you have that I would – really like everybody to print and have with them, sitting on your desk, getting ready when you take the exam. All right. I'll show you guys a couple of them here. You've seen the other ones, the AP rubric, but I made a checklist. There we go. There we go. So if you can see, if anybody printed it, you know what I mean? That'd be different. That'd be pretty awesome, but you didn't have to already. I'm gonna move this around so I can see your questions still. So you have it. I have the 2020 AP exam day checklist, which is from the College Board. And it gives you, you know, a place where you're supposed to write your name, your ID number, which you're going to get on probably tomorrow sometime. That's what they said 2 days before. And so you'll get that ID, and you'll have, what else is on there? I'll bring it up here. And you'll write your name on here. Make sure your device is plugged in. When you click on a link, it opens Chrome. You've practiced that demo, which everybody should have done by now. And then I put on there, you know, the AP history rubric, which is, you know, the actual rubric, which how many points you get and everything like that. And the DBQ worksheet, which I've updated. I'll bring that up here in a second. I updated it. And so you need, if you downloaded it and you're just printing off that one, print off the new one. It's on there. It's on that post I just put on Google Classroom this morning. It has an updated thing, and I'll bring it up here in a second. But let's go through this list. So I had it sourcing the documents worksheet, which I made yesterday. So you know how to source the documents and how you can start off the sentences to help you out. Note cards separated by period. So that way it's easiest, you know, as soon as you get your question, you can be like, okay, rest of those, I don't need anymore. You know what I mean? You can set them off. You could put maybe the period before and after off to the side, and then the one you have, and then the rest of them you don't need, because you could pull evidence, you know, from both of them if you need them. Something to drink, right? But not too much to drink, because you can't go to the bathroom. You don't have enough time. I mean, if you got to go, you got to go. But, you know, I would definitely... I mean, I just drink a lot, so I know. You have a Word or Google Doc open with your name and AP ID already on it, ready to go when this, you know, happens. So you're looking at the documents, and you don't even have to worry about that. You can either, if you're copying and pasting, then you just boom, boom, it's already on there. You make sure you have your name and ID number copied and pasted. Then you have your Or if you're going to save, it's already on there. It's already in a saved place. All you have to do is, you don't have to save as, you don't have to, it's already saved. All you have to do is hit save and then upload and attach, right? Everybody should be practicing that demo. Make sure you know what to do. And if you have notes that you're going to try and use, Grammarly program is disabled, all right? So you can't use that. And I will not go on forums or social media sites during the exam, right? Don't do it. Just don't do it, okay? And if you don't know what forums are, that's, you know, anywhere where you can ask a question and people can answer you, all right? Yes, 100%. But it's, I mean, you can take it wherever you want. You just, you know what I mean? You can't take it. You would have to, I don't know why you're asking that question, but, you know, I would be wary of not taking it because your IP address, if you don't know anything about that. I think so, Jackie. I think you'll be able to print those documents out. Yeah. Can the college work? Yeah, so, Pia, I would make sure, you know what I mean? I'm pretty sure you can't take this somewhere else where somebody else has taken it. So an IP address is like, you know, wherever you're logged on. That's how computers, it's like your address. But it's whatever router you're going through, unless you're like some crazy hacker and have VPNs and, you know, all those things. I don't know. I don't know anything about that stuff. But, and use the bathroom before it starts. So I just got this checklist of things that you can do. You're logged in at 1:30 using your e-ticket. So let's go back to the DBQ worksheet here. Let me bring that one back up. So this one should look familiar to you, right? I added some changes to it, and you can see them here. You can see I put the points. So document work, you have 3 points. For that HAP, you have, why did I put DBQ? Huh. I don't know why I put that. That should say 2 points. That's weird. I'll check and make sure that that's right on the other one. Okay. 2 points. Okay. You, because if you look at your rubric, all right, for it, you have, which is on the second page, you have, you know, you can get two, well, it's on the first page, actually. Evidence, you can get 2 points for it, okay? Yeah. So, yeah, patented. But I put that on there. So you have 3 points for the document work. Use content from 4 documents to accurately describe the content. That will give you 3 points if you use content from 4 of the 5 documents, okay? And then, you know, this is grouping. This is going to give you points. It's just going to help you group the organization of it together. Now, respond your thesis. This is the big thing I think a lot of people kind of missed. But you need to respond to the prompt, not just restate it. So you have to respond to what it's saying. Now, don't just restate what it's saying. All right. There's a big difference there. And that's 1 point. Your contextualization is 1 point, and you're just describing a broader historical event, development, or process. So if you're talking about something, if the prompt is talking about something within, say the, I'm trying to think of something, you could have like the women's rights movement, okay? The right to vote, women's suffrage. You could have the broader thing would be the progressive movement, okay, which we're about to talk about today, Okay, so that's broader, it's bigger, but it encompasses that original thing. All right, does everyone understand that point? And how does it connect to it? Very easy. You come up with two or three vocab words that go along with it. All right, and then you have evidence beyond the document, and that's 2 points. And you're using two different specific evidences that are different than the evidence you use in the contextualization. So it's just different than these. It's two of them, and you can get 2 points, okay? And good morning, Alex. And you know what I mean? I know a lot of you have been asking, you know, what's a passing grade, how many points, those types of things. We don't know that, but I'm pretty sure if you get a six, if you get 6 points, you're passing 100%, okay? So you need to make sure when the AP College Board people were taking about quoting, they said not to use quotes. Yeah, yeah, you're not supposed to use quotes. There's nothing in here that I'm saying don't use your own words. You don't need to quote it because they know the documents backwards and forwards. So you don't need to quote it. You're just kind of wasting time. You can just refer to it and just kind of summarize what they said, but you don't have to use quotes. I know it seems kind of different, but make sure that, you know, you don't need to, you're just going to waste time. So, I mean, for me, when I've done these, you know, I would spend about 8 minutes reading the documents. They say 10, but I think you could, I mean, I don't know. It depends on how your reading comprehension is, right? I would spend about 8 minutes reading them, you know, read the prompt, spend about 8 minutes. And then I would just do a small portion of that, right? Of this worksheet, not the whole thing, but just like as you're reading, you could be like, oh, there's a point, bam, bam. That's where I could do that. That's where I could mention that. And you just put it in there. And then as you're writing, you can just refer to it really quickly. That's what I would do, you know, personally. And, you know, but you, whatever's comfortable for you, because this is one of those things where, you know, I can tell you all the best things in the world, and some things are going to be universal, but a lot of things are going to be what you're good at and what you feel comfortable doing. And, you know, I put this, you have it down in the corner. Remember, name, explain, connect. So name what you're talking about, explain it, and then connect it back to the document. Okay. And what was the other point? Not the actual points. So that if you add those up, the 3, the 2, right, 5. There's another point somewhere. I don't know. I'll look at it. Right. I did it all this morning. It was early. Because you can get the evidence is 5. 5, 6, 7. And analysis and reason. Oh, you have the complexity point. Okay. That's the only one that's not up there because I don't know. You know, try for it. You might get it, right? But as far as, you know, it's really hard. So don't fret about the complexity point. You know, you can still, I'm pretty sure you'll be able to get a 4, definitely a 4 without it. Not sure what the 5 score will be like yet, okay? So, yeah, don't fret about it too much, okay? Hopefully that should be a good amount of things here. All right, what else for this week before we get started? I don't know. I think that's about it. We have, we just have, I'm sorry. I didn't turn off my cell phone. Oh, this is, I'm getting some wheels done. Sorry about this. I have to respond sometimes, you know. That's with live. So, Progressive Roots. Sorry, I don't want to keep you guys waiting. I'll do it while they're... Right. The biggest thing with the progressivism is that they're trying to get away from that industrialism. And I'll be there. You guys are like, what are you doing, Mr. Green? Hopefully that's good enough for him. All right. So remember laissez-faire? That was hands-off capitalism, just letting it go rampant and businesses do whatever they want. And you have the industrialization of everything. And the roots were, back in the day, you had the Populist Party and then you had the Greenback Party. Okay. And these should all remember the muckrakers, all right? These people that came in, Jacob Riss, Ida Tarbell, she's the big one, right? And Upton Sinclair, who wrote The Jungle. They're muckrakers. They're pulling up the muck to bring it to the surface, to have everybody available. Everybody available. Sorry, my head's other places. You know, so they bring all this corruption and stuff to the surface so everybody can see exactly what's going on here, all right? And this is the first one. And Jacob Riss really, remember these pictures we looked at of, like, just how horrible the slums were in New York City? And it really was, people couldn't ignore it anymore. And that's what really, and people couldn't ignore what was happening in these slums because, again, you know, when you bring it to somebody's attention, right, things happen. You know, you have the big thing that's going on in the news today with Ahmaud, and, you know, he was shot and killed in Georgia, and that was, you know, a while ago, but until the video surfaced, people didn't pay attention to it. That's all right, Phoebe. And just make sure you go back and watch the beginning. And, you know, when you show people things and they can see pictures of it, right? It's happened a lot of times in modern days. Like, I remember, who was that guy? Running back for Baltimore, whatever. He had an altercation with his wife. He hit his wife in public, and nothing really happened until that video surfaced, right? And then he got fired, and basically he lost everything. But once people see things and they can see pictures, especially, you know, we have pictures now at this time period, so you bring it out to light and people are like, oh my gosh, you can't ignore it anymore. And that's what these guys are doing. And so you have Ida Tarbell, and she's the one who brought down John D. Rockefeller. All right. And his tactics of pushing out the middlemen, of buying up railroad time, even if he's not even using it. So smaller oil companies couldn't use it. Like, you literally buy up the railroad time and not ship anything on it. You just have empty containers. So that way, because he had so much money, and that's what you can do if you have that much money and you can force out small competitors, is he just bought up the whole train. And then when they would try to, you know, oh, we need our things transported. Oh, we don't have any room. Well, how about the next one? Nah, none there. How about the next one? Nope. So they couldn't get their stuff. And then he'd call them up and be like, hey, I really like your business. I want to buy it. And they're like, I mean, we can't even get our stuff shipped out. Like, how are you going to buy it? And he's like, well, I can get it. I have people. And then he would buy their business. And then he would just open it back up. And then, you know, more and more, he just kept doing that. And he owned the whole 90% of the market, right? And the so the next one, Upton Sinclair. This is the big one. This is, he went undercover in the meatpacking plants in Chicago. And just how horrendous the conditions were that this meat was, because they did not care, and there was nobody regulating it. I watched that movie Dark Waters about DuPont with Mark Ruffalo the other night with my wife. It was really good. If you want a good movie to watch, you should watch it. And it's about Teflon and stuff. But it's really, really good. And it really put Congress, again, you know, put it out there in the front and for everybody to see, and everybody had to read it and make sure that they knew what was going on. Oh, that thing got twisted. There we go. And, you know, these, so this is all progressivism. So these are all things that you could point out if they're talking about progressive, all these people, okay? So, and, you know, the cure for all this was democracy, was that people could, the regular people could outnumber the rich, they could bring them to light, they could make sure that they weren't taking it, because that's the thing, is like, as a regular person, you don't have time to regulate the beef industry, right? I don't have time to regulate the beef industry. I rely on the federal government and the FDA, right? And the USDA, I guess it would be the USDA, to regulate the beef industry, right? I can't go out there on the farms in Central Florida and Texas and Wyoming and be like, let me see your beef and how it's being raised, right? Oh, well, you're not giving them the right cattle. You're giving them too much. You know, and I can't do that. I got to teach you guys. This is enough work. And you know, when you guys have a job, you're not going to be able to, unless you want to do that, you're not going to do that either. So that's what it is. You know what I mean? You have to rely at some point, unless you want to, you know, grow your own everything. You have to rely on somebody else to regulate and ensure your safety. It's like, you know, with airbags and with all those recalls, you know what I mean? When they make something that's unsafe, you rely on the government to, you know, try to protect you, protect the citizens. Now, do they always do it? No, because they're in the pockets of some of these big, huge businesses. If you watch Dark Waters, you know, that's a prime example of it with DuPont, because it's just the sheer amount of money that they have. And so that's why you have a lot of people, a lot of businesses, you know, corrupting politicians. So most of the middle class, that's where you're going to get your progressives. All right. He texted me back. And most of your middle class are your, because they're the ones that are going to have the time, right? The working class, I ain't got time for that, right? They don't have time, and they are relying on the government for everything, and they're working, you know, 18 hours a day, blah, blah, blah. They don't have time. So big business, they're not going to do, the rich people aren't going to do it because they don't want to, because they're making the money. So it's a middle class that's the progressives, and even more so the women. Right, because they still aren't in the workforce yet, so they're still at home, and they have a lot more time. And especially the middle class women, they have time and they want to do these things, right? We're not going to do that. So the political reforms, okay? So initiative, referendum, and recall. All right. So these are things that they did as progressives, where, you know, this, the initiative, that one is, That one's not a lot, especially not today. But the referendum is, politicians do that all the time. We have a referendum almost on every ballot because they pass it to the voters. I mean, to it so we can approve it and say, okay, we like that, we don't. You know, a lot of it's the legalization of marijuana. You know, that's on, you know, so many states' referendums all the time, or like taxes and things like that are referendums. One of it is to give the people the power to vote, and but then it's also giving the people, you know, the consequence. Like, if you mess this up or you do it and it sucks, then who are you going to blame? You can't blame anybody. You the people did it, right? So the politicians are like, wasn't me, right? It was you guys. So that's, you know, with the referendum. And then a recall, then you can recall officials that do a horrible job. Now, you can't recall the president. I mean, you can have impeachments and remove them from office for things. But it's too big of a thing. You can't recall the president, but you can recall like more local officials and reappoint new ones. All right. And that happens. That happens with city council, sometimes a mayor, something like that. You don't really have it anything larger than that usually. All right. And this is the big one, secret ballots. Right. So that way you don't have the Tammany Hall, Boss Tweed, thugs in there with their bats looking at you, and you're like getting ready to put it in there, and you look, you know, you're putting John Smith in this one, and the guy, and you look at the guy, and he just shakes his head, and you're like, oh, okay, and then you take the other ballot and you put in the other one, right? You don't want that. That's not good for anybody. I mean, that's why you can't have people around voting booths today. You can have to be a certain distance away. That way you can't get pressure to vote a certain way. And my second cup of coffee today. Made one at like 4:30 in the morning. I'm going to take a nice nap later on this afternoon. They were protecting the votes. Yeah, that's what it was. They were protecting the votes. That's funny. And then the big one, okay, direct election of senators. Because before this, the senators were appointed by the House members, all right? Now the people get to vote their senators in, all right? So it's giving more of a voice to the people, right? And senators are big, that's a big thing, right? Because they have a lot of power, each one. Because there's only two per state. So there's only two senators that represent 55 million people in California, but there's also two senators that represent 500,000 people in Wyoming, right? So, you know, that's that Virginia versus New Jersey plan, right? The Great Compromise, 1877. So, I think that was, and then finally, female suffrage in 1920. Finally, right? I hate everyone. Aw. I don't think you mean that. I think you meant something else. Pretty sure. Because we all like you, Rebecca. I made that one bigger. Good for me. Let's make me smaller. And it definitely took off a little bit more. let me click over here. There we go. And where's what? Local leaders cracked down on that. Was, you know what I mean? They really wanted to stop people taking advantage, especially of minorities, of children, of, you know, and Wisconsin was the leader for that, okay? And that's a really weird state to be the leader of, right? Like progressivism, Wisconsin, right? Up in Wisconsin. I think that's the accent. I don't know. I'm not sure. And because it progressivism needed to just take off at the local level, right? You needed people to start taking advantage of their own, you know, communities, and then it would spread. People would see, oh, that's a good thing. We should do that in our community. And then it has a movement and it keeps going, right? And it just builds and builds and builds, and then it finally will get national. Most of the reform movements, get out of here. Realtor.com. Sorry, I gotta turn this thing off. Distracting me. There we go. Dead silent, no vibrations. And they're the ones that are gonna foster and start all these changes because, you know, they're not working. I know a lot of them would rather work, but they're not working. Middle class, they have time, and they have their men are mozzarella cheese. This is some inside thing that I don't, that because I'm old, I don't get, right? And the child labor, right? Because they're moms, they see their children, right? They have a little bit more empathy. Even though they're not their own children, but other people's children being taken advantage of in this way. And they're also going to be the leaders in the temperance movement. Okay. I don't know what that means either. I guess it was on the PSAT in 2018. So they're also going to be the leaders of the temperance movement, which is the... You know, I'll leave that. I was going to answer it, but we'll leave it here. This one, Triangle Shirtwaist Company, fire, right? You should be remembering this. Okay. I was like, but it was like specific with mozzarella cheese. And then I was like, what? Because they're not known for their mozzarella. They're known for the cheddar. The cheddar cheese. This was horrible, horrible circumstance because of a lot of safety violations. These very, very young women, a lot of them in their teens, in their upper teens, you know, not much older than you guys, early 20s, working in these shirt waists. This is a very popular item for people to wear back then. And it, because of how bad the situation was, there was like locked emergency exits, and a lot of these women just died. A lot of them jumped out of the windows, and they perished. And it brought to light the horrible conditions that a lot of people were working in, especially in the big cities, in these factories. All right. And there was no workers' compensation laws. Like, remember we talked about the child labor, like, if you have a child, and I mean, think how many, if you have younger brothers or yourself, how many times you got injured just because you were stupid, right? And you just did something because you're a kid, and you're like, don't touch that hot thing. And you're like, what? And it burnt me. You know, I told you not to touch it. Yeah, but I had to see. And, you know, you do stupid things like that. And so the children would get, you know, 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds working in a factory barefoot, right? You're going to get injured. But there's no workers' compensation, so they don't care about you. So if you got injured, you just got fired. And it really, you know, it pushed it forward. And it always happens when you have movements. You always have certain events that are like a trigger, and you go, boom, and you can point to it. And there's a couple of them in like the civil rights movement that we're going to get to. That is going to move everything forward. There's always events that really happen that move, you know, you could point to John Brown and Harper's Ferry, you know, Virginia. That's a big event that pushes. It's not the overall cause of the Civil War. The overall cause of the Civil War is slavery, but it's something that pushed it like over the edge, right? It was that cat right on the edge of the sitting on the counter. And he keeps nudging the glass off, and you look at him and you go, no. And then he just goes, knocks it right off, right? That was Harper's Ferry. That was Triangle Shirtwaist Company. It just kind of, you guys can't see that that whole thing here. I'll put this here. There we go. It'll make me even smaller. There we go. You don't need to see me. You know what I look like. Yeah, that looks better. Sorry about that. What do we got now? Now, alcohol, temperance movement, 18th Amendment. Remember, if you have anything about alcohol, progressive, you have the what the amendments are, 18th and 21st, right? And easy to remember, 18 was the first drinking age, and then it went to 21. So 18th Amendment, 21st Amendment, all right? Easy, chicken greasy. Now, Teddy Roosevelt, big progressive, is progressive president, and this is what he pursues after he gets elected, okay? The three C's: control of the corporations, consumer protection, conservation of natural resources. That's a big thing he's known for, is the natural resources, and that's a big thing why he goes back in. Remember Taft comes in, and then he's sitting on the sidelines, and Taft isn't the big natural resources person, so he comes back and he runs, and then they take each other's votes. And okay, so I went forward a little too quick right there, I know. So you have, let's see, where are we at now on this? Oh, okay. You know, it's just his labor. What is he doing for the labor? He's trying to corral the corporations. They create the Department of Commerce and Labor. Is very important to protect and to deal with things like strikes, the coal miners. Remember, he was going to bring in the army because it was affecting the whole nation. It wasn't just affecting a business, right? A president's not going to get in a labor dispute if it's over, you know, producing socks, right? Because that's not going to affect the nation. Now, if there's something around gasoline, and there's no gasoline, right, then the president will get involved, because then that's going to affect the entire nation as a whole, and it can affect it adversely, you know, huge, and have a big impact on the United States. Now, everybody talks about him as being the trust breaker, but it's really Taft. The only one he gets and is Northern Securities Company, and that's J.P. Morgan's. Anybody remember what J.P. Morgan? Remember, it was like this with the boards. It's a big term. Yeah, there was gasoline in the 70s. Yeah, they had a gas shortage in the 70s. But that was because of OPEC. That's nothing that the president can do. That was in the Middle East. Close. Executive board hog. Board of directors. It's close. Executive board hog. Yeah, I mean, that's basically what they're doing. But, you know, here you go, the American Hercules. Interlocking directorates. Good job, Danny. You know, this is him wrestling the bull, wrestling. Danny just beat David. Good job. Now, this one, the biggest one here, the Forest Reserve Act. All right, I adjusted some of these so I didn't have to put all of them up there. I took some of them off from what we learned in class. And it really, we showed that, you know, not everything is exhaustible, right? We have a lot of land, but we need to conserve it. And because Teddy Roosevelt was so adamant about this, and yes, him and John Muir went at it at two different ways. John Muir was like, just leave it alone. Don't even, you know, build parks on it. Just set it aside and nobody gets to use it. But Teddy Roosevelt, a little bit, I mean, to me, it makes more sense, right? Sensibly use it, because if people can't use it, people don't want to protect it, right? It's like, it would be, you know what I mean? If they can't see anything of their sacrifice of paying for it, then it's hard to charge somebody for it, right? Even though it's a good thing to do, it's hard to charge somebody when they can't use it. So if they can use it, and then you can, you can charge admission, you can charge all these things. It's just like hunting and fishing licenses. Remember I told you guys about that? Like, how many people gave $100 towards Florida Fish and Wildlife this year? I did, right? Because I bought a hunting license, right? And that goes to Fish and Wildlife. That goes to conservation of lands, of management areas, and that's what allows those areas to stay and to keep industries from moving in, from buying them up, from pressuring, because they have this ability to do that. So that's the big thing, is, you know, to pay for it. And when you pay for something, then people are like, oh, I can go visit it, and I can go see Grand Canyon. I can go see Yellowstone. Can you imagine if nobody could go to Yellowstone, and then you're asking them to pay millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars to manage it? And they're like, well, we can't even go see it. You know what I mean? That's why you have a lot of pushback, like a lot of people want to see a lot of the military, the battleships that we have. And like, oh, we want to go see them. And that's why the Navy and the Army, and they do those big shows. The big air shows, because it's like, we want you to spend, you know, $110 million for that crappy F-35 airplane per plane, right? And so that's why, you know, people want to see it. Yvonne sent me some pictures of the SR-71 Blackbird, which I've never seen one in person. I want to see it in person so bad. And if you don't know what that is, look it up. Baddest plane ever. And, you know, I'm all for spending money on military, but that's why they show it off to the public, because then it makes people go, oh, that's really cool. Innovation, you know, we'll spend money on military. And that's what it is, okay? I remember that one. That one's funny. Oh, this is so true. Oh, my God. Yes, it is, Yuri, the X-Men's plane. I think that's what they based it off of. It looks a lot very similar. That's true, too. Hashtag truth. Good morning, Thomas. And if you don't get this one, if you're driving something with a turbo, your gas is on the right, brake is in the middle, clutch is on the left, you're like, burr, psh, burr, psh. I know Logan's trying to get a blow-off valve on his car, and it makes that sound. Have you ever heard a car sound like that? That's what it is. It's their turbo letting some pressure out. All right. Or you hear a car like just idling next to you, and it's like, and you just hear like this. And you remember me explaining it, Victoria? Yeah. So it's only funny for car people, but you know, whatever. I don't care. I like cars. Yep. Did you get it this time at least? Did I explain it better? Hopefully I did. I don't know. Maybe not. Yeah, mine, you know, one of them has a much deeper exhaust note than that. Yay! See? Teaching you all kinds of stuff. This is funny. I remember doing how I did this. They were black and they... I don't know why I spent the time doing this nonsense. So Roosevelt doesn't run for a third term. And it's a small panic, because it was like, what's going to happen? Who's going to be there? And oh my gosh, another mean break. That's crazy. I know, all kinds in there. I think I deleted a bunch of stuff out of this. That's why. So they did have a little bit of panic, but this is because Roosevelt, he could have, if he ran again, 100% he would have won, right? And the only Roosevelts that would have had, only presidents that would have had three terms would have been Roosevelts. And So he doesn't run. Taft wins, or Taft runs, and he endorses Taft at the beginning. But then after 4 years, he sees that Taft isn't doing the right things. And then he comes back in 1908, right? So, mean break. Again, there we go. Pitcher's Duel. Burr. Hamilton. You should get that one, right? Ding dong. Your religion is wrong. And if you don't get that one, look them up. You should know who they are. Yeah, because remember, Roosevelt, Panama Canal, gets it done. except they didn't even have to go through it, right? This would be even better. It would be like a better meme if it was like France, it was the whole thing. And then there was just a door frame, and then, but there was no wall, and they could just walk around the door. That'd be an even better meme. And if you don't know your World War II history, I can't help you on that one. You should. You should be okay. Now, this is Taft's dollar diplomacy. And Wall Street's going to start investing in other nations. All right? And so what you do is basically you're loaning money to other nations. That gives us, because when you loan a loan money to another nation, it gives you a say in what they, in your control of their country, right? You get some influence in that country when you, that's why people don't like the fact that China has, you know, I think they have like one or two trillion of U.S. debt is China controls. But I mean, we're gonna be at like 28 trillion after this is all over. I bet somewhere around there. It's gonna be crazy. And you know, Roosevelt was a little more in your face with his big stick policy. That whole thing. Taft was a little behind the scenes. You know, a little more politically savvy type way of doing it. And that's what dollar diplomacy is. All right. Oh, I remember seeing this and I was like, I'll change the colors. And I was like, I remember how everybody hated it. And I was like, nah, I'm going to leave it. It's kind of funny. So what he wanted to do was Manchuria was an area, and it's right next to Russia and Japan. And he wanted to buy it, and then turn it over to China. And then strengthen that open door policy. Remember what the open door policy was the opening of China to trade to everybody, not just those spheres of influence, right? For the different European nations, that's where you had the Boxer Rebellion and you had all that stuff. I know, sometimes I'm going to get better. I really want to write, hopefully, I don't know, they said spending freeze. I'm going to write all new PowerPoints for everything based on the new book. If I find out that we're going to get a book. So that's what my goal is to do that. Yeah, this whole, I know. Trust me, I know. And you have the Monroe Doctrine. Remember, the United States can only invest. And then you have the Roosevelt Corollary, which was just strengthening of the Monroe Doctrine. And as we invest more and more dollars, that means we're going to get more and more involved. It's just like anything. If, like, you know, people talk about the federal government being involved in education, and they shouldn't be, because it's not up to the federal government for education. It's down to the states, right? But if the federal government gives you money, then it's going to come with stipulations, right? It's like if you ask your parents to borrow money and you go, hey, mom, can I borrow $100? And she's like, sure, honey, what for? And you're like, I really want to get this tattoo of a scorpion with a moon behind it. And the scorpion is stinging a little tiny teddy bear. And she's going to be like, no, absolutely not. But if you said, mom, I want to borrow $100 because I want to go down and donate it to Food for Families, because there's a lot of people that have, have a hard time right now and getting food and things like that. She'll probably say yes, right? Same thing. She can tell you, yes, I'll do it. There's stipulations on what you can do with that money. It's the same thing. As the U.S. is investing in countries, they can be like, hey, you shouldn't do that. And they'll be like, well, we want to. And they're like, well, you're not going to get any more money. And they'll be like, ah, oh, damn it. Right? It's the same thing. So you need to understand that, you know, right? As a country gets more involved in another one, as far as donating, not donating money, but loaning them money. And now it's just loaning them. It's not like you're even giving it to them, right? Just like your mom. She's not giving you the money for the tattoo. She was going to loan it to you, but she's not going to loan it to you for that stupid tattoo. She's going to, you know, but if it's something for Food for Family, she might say, okay, well, I'll match it. If you do 100, I'll do another 100, right? Something like that. And that'd be cool. So the big one for Taft is Standard Oil. Okay. And this, the U.S. Steel Company thought it was, Roosevelt thought it was, Teddy thought it was a good trust. Right. And this really kind of started that feud, between the two of them, also with the lack of natural resource protection, that Taft wasn't really involved in, cause he was not really an outdoorsy type dude. It really, that's what set, good morning, Siona. Good morning. That's what really set up, the 1908 election. Okay. And so this is what split the Republican Party, the tariffs, conservation of lands. All right. Okay. Now, there's a lot of stuff on here that you don't really have to know, okay? But when Taft splits the Republican Party, all right, because Taft was a mild progressive, all right, he wasn't as progressive as Roosevelt. That's a big thing that you would, if you have anything about, now, I don't know if you're going to have anything on progressive, because they've already given us, you know, that question. So it'd be very... It'd be very weird if they had another question. It could be similar though, but you could draw comparisons to the progressive, and then stuff like this would help you on other questions, right? But as far as, you know, I don't think they're going to have, you know, something as far as progressive party and, you know, how, what it meant for social change and things like that. So really the thing on here, the biggest thing is the progressives, the conservation of land, okay? And that was a big part of it, okay? And that's what Roosevelt was for. And that was the split. And that's why Roosevelt ran as a third party. Well, I got two more slides left. So the 1910 congressional, did I say 19? I think I said, I messed that up. I'm sorry. Again, you're all right. Because you have the midterm election, right? That's the election in between your presidential elections. It's called a midterm. And in 1910, that's when it splits. And that's when we're going to get Wilson. Okay. They won their Democrats won the majority in the House, and then they're going to win the next election. All right. Yeah, I mean, that's it. So the big thing of this is, Roosevelt really causes them to lose the election, because again, third party, you're just taking votes away from one side. You're not taking votes away from both sides. Okay. So, yeah, that's it. And then, we'll finish up, period seven tomorrow, and it'll be Wednesday and then Thursday and then your test. So if you have not done a demo, for the test, You need to do that. It's on our stream on Google Classroom. There's things for people who came in late. I posted on Google Classroom this morning early. It has a list of things that you should be looking at. I'll pull it up here again. Right here. And yeah. And let me get rid of the PowerPoint here. So this just has a things that you need to do, and I updated the DBQ worksheet with points so you could have that sitting there while you're taking the test. So this is, you know, just a Push Green exam day checklist, okay, of things that you need to have on exam day. Ready to go, you know, print this off. If you can't print this, you too, Nathan, and I wrote on there on the Google Classroom, you know, you have Staples, FedEx, and a lot of these stores are open. They have printers at Publix. They have Office Depot, the FedEx store, the UPS store, any type of printing place. If you look up just printing, it's really cheap. It's not, you know what I mean? It's only like 8 pages if you don't have a printer at home. I just think it's going to be really easy for you to look at these things while they're on a piece of paper rather than digital on your computer. So yeah. And if you don't have one, you know, I don't know, try really see if you can find somebody that has one. If I lived really close to you, I'd just bring them to you. It wouldn't be a big deal. I'd print them off. I think that's all I got. So you guys have a great day. And make sure you're practicing, make sure you're going over your note cards whenever you have downtime. And if you have questions, yes, get your stuff done. And, if you have questions, hit me up and I will try and, answer those as best as possible and as quickly as possible. I've answered a number of them over the last couple days. And, you know, just send them to me and I'll get back to you as soon as I possibly can. So everybody have a great day and I will see you tomorrow, mañana. Bye-bye.